Welcome to Biology 315, Principles of Microbiology. I am your absentee professor, Rachel McElpring. First of all, I want to thank you for your patience while I've been gone. Currently, I am in South Korea at the International Society for Microbial Ecology Conference. So, like you, I'm busy listening to people talk about topics they care a lot more about than I do. I will be an email contact, and the best way to get a hold of me is through email, and I will try and answer urgent emails promptly. If you're trying to add the class, email me and we will discuss. It looks like I'll be able to open up several extra seats, so hopefully everyone who wants a spot will be able to get in the class. So let's start out talking about the syllabus. Hooray! I will let you read the nitty-gritty details on your own, but what I want to do is go through it and point out some of the most important pieces. So first of all, this is an outline of the topics that I plan to cover during the course. As you can see, there are two midterm exams and a cumulative final exam. I'll try to stick as closely as I can to the schedule, but as you might have experienced in lots of other classes, some people are more successful at this than others, and I imagine there will be a little bit of deviation from the precise topics. Like I said previously, the very best way to get a hold of me is through email, and I have office hours scheduled this fall on Monday from 1 to 5:50 p.m., and also, I will be available for office hours by appointment. So if you can't make the Monday time, please email me and we'll be able to set up a time to meet. My office is in Eucalyptus Hall, 2207. So let's talk about the textbook a little bit. So first of all, you may have heard from people in my previous classes that a textbook is not needed. And while some people may have been able to get by without it, don't trust them, because this semester I'm going to be relying on the textbook a little bit more heavily. So there will actually be assignments and mini quizzes based on the readings. Now you can either purchase the textbook at the bookstore or online. Ebooks are also available, and you can purchase chapter by chapter. Most of the chapters that we're going to need are in the syllabus, but I might add one or two chapters depending on the topics and availability. So if you're doing a chapter by chapter type of purchase, you may need to purchase one or two additional chapters in the course of the semester. Like I said previously, there are two exams, two midterms, and a final, and there's a category called assignments, which is about 50 points. So there'll be little mini quizzes, little mini assignments during the course of the semester, which I imagine will add up to about 50 points, though the point distribution may change a little bit subject to my discretion. Grading policy. Grades will be based on the standard ABCD plus minus system. Students within 2% of the next higher grade may enhance their chances of achieving a higher grade by a final exam score at or above that grade or continual improvement in exam scores, but that is due or subject solely to my discretion, and I rarely use that clause, though sometimes I do. You are welcome to argue your points with me. Should you decide to do this, I will regrade your entire exam. I try to be generous the first time around, but may not be so generous the second time. Partial credit is a privilege and not a right. However, if I've made a genuine mistake, which I have been known to do, please come and see me and I will correct it as soon as possible. Now, one thing to note is if I cannot read your handwriting or you don't write coherently, that is, you don't write sentences that make sense, you cannot get credit. I'm not going to spend 20 minutes trying to interpret what you've written down. You need to write clearly, concisely, and with legible handwriting. Other stuff, this is standard, no cheating, the biology withdrawal policy is the same as it is throughout the biology department. if you have a disability, go and talk to the folks at the Center on Disabilities and DRESS, and I'm happy to make arrangements through them. And finally, I don't give incompletes. Should circumstances require you to be for work to be finished after the semester, I will give you the grade earned at the end of the semester and then change the grade later. So no incompletes. So first things first, let's talk about what microbes are. Well, they're small. No surprise there. The loose definition is that it requires a microscope to be seen. There are generally exceptions to the rule. There are very large bacterium and there are algae that can be seen with the naked eye. In addition, there are some small organisms that are not microbes. We have a couple of examples here that outline exceptions to the rule. The first one is Thiomargarita namibiensis, and this is a very large bacterium found off of Namibia. In the next slide, I have, well, a screenshot of John Stewart doing a little bit on this particular organism back from when it was first found. Under normal circumstances, I just show the clip in class, but there are issues streaming it. So if you feel so inclined, Google the piece because he gets it hilariously right and wrong at the same time. If you're not so inclined, I'll subject you to it when I return. Now, another example on the other end of the spectrum is an algae that is also very large. I guess that's not on the other end of the spectrum. It's just another exception to the rule. And this guy is Calpura taxifolia. And you may have heard of this. In the 1980s, there was a zoo in Germany that found a strain of this algae that thrives in cold water. So they performed some selective breeding that made it even hardier, and then it escaped into the Mediterranean Sea. The problem is that it's crowding out native plants while being inedible to native species, and it's becoming an enormous problem in the Mediterranean. Now, a couple of other things about microbes. They are living creatures. They metabolize food. They grow and reproduce. The exception to this are viruses, which are non-cellular. And when we get to the section on viruses, we'll discuss a little bit whether or not viruses are considered life and why people are a little bit ambiguous about that definition. Here's the video clip, or a screenshot from the video clip that I promised. Like I said, go ahead and search for it, or I'll show it when I get to class. There are six major groups of microbes studied by microbiologists, and they are divided into three categories: prokaryotes, eukaryotes, and viruses. So a prokaryote is an organism whose cell or cells lack a nucleus. So those are filed under the categories of bacteria and archaea. Whereas a eukaryote is an organism whose cell contains a nucleus. So there are eukaryotic organisms that are considered microbes, and those are algae, protists, and fungi. The third group, or the third category under which the six groups fall, are viruses, and they're non-cellular particles with a genome, and these can only replicate inside of a cell. So let's talk a little bit about the discovery of microbes. Light microscopes were invented in the 1600s, and the quality of these microscopes improved continuously. So the very first microorganisms that were observed were small eukaryotes, such as fungi, and those are pictured right here, and they were obviously the first to be observed because they tend to be larger and can be seen at resolutions that render smaller organisms unviewable. Now, in the late 1600s, Van Leeuwenhoek discovered bacteria, And what he did is he took teeth scrapings before and after he drank coffee and used a primitive microscope to view the organisms on the teeth scraping. So one important thing to note, and hopefully this will come up again and again in class, is that he was the first to see the microbes and report the findings. So when you're talking about getting credit for scientific work, for those of you who are interested in going into the sciences, reporting your findings is incredibly important. So he was the first one to see and report the findings. And this idea of publishing your results and getting credit for it has a very long history. And he made his own very simple microscope. And a diagram of it is shown right here. And next to the diagram of the microscope are the figures that appear in his paper of the bacterial cells that he was able to observe. And what you're seeing here is a modern day recreation of the microscope. And you can see it's quite a bit different from modern day microscopes that we use in 315, but the basic components are there. You have a lens that magnifies the object, and you have a stage that you can put the object on. And this small microscope was sufficient enough to observe bacteria. And if you hear an odd noise in the background, please forgive me for that. There is construction going on in the lab next door to where I'm recording this. Anyway, let's talk a little bit more about what happened after the discovery of microorganisms. So in the 17th century, there was this debate over the organisms of not only microbes, but other small organisms. And there were two hypotheses. And those hypotheses were spontaneous generation and biogenesis. So spontaneous generation is the hypothesis that these small organisms can just arise out of nothing, whereas biogenesis is the hypothesis that life comes from life. That is, that reproduction has to occur for life to take place. And while it seems pretty obvious nowadays, back in the 1700s, this was very relevant and interesting. So stop to think for a moment how you would differentiate between spontaneous generation and biogenesis. What type of experiments would you design to differentiate from it? Now, the very first experiments weren't focused on microorganisms, but other small organisms. So take this experiment. And in that experiment that they performed, they placed meat in an unsealed jar. Flies laid eggs on the meat, and maggots emerged. In the second experiment, meat was placed in a sealed jar. The flies could not enter, and maggots did not form. And finally, the third experiment was meat was placed in a jar covered with gauze, and flies couldn't enter, and maggots did not form. So based on this set of experiments, the conclusion was that maggots arise from eggs laid by flies, not by spontaneous generation. So this supports the theory of biogenesis, which states that all life arises from other life. So now let's talk about spontaneous generation versus biogenesis, using microbes rather than maggots as an example. In the experiment where they sealed the meat in the container and flies didn't enter, no maggots were found. However, the meat still putrefied. Or another word for putrefied is it went bad. Imagine if you left meat on your counter for a week or so, it would start to get pretty rancid smelling. So what does this imply about the spontaneous generation of microbes? So at first glance, it might suggest that microorganisms might arise from spontaneous generation. So this was this also was a large question, and I want you to think about how you would test this. It becomes a little bit harder to test and differentiate between spontaneous generation and biogenesis when you're talking about something on such a small scale like microbes rather than something a little larger like maggots. So the experiment that was performed to address this question was conducted in 1799, and what the gentleman Lazzaro did, who designed this experiment, is he set up a flask with some sterile broth, so broth that didn't have any microbes in it, and he made the flask open to the air, that is, made it so that microbes could drop in. And microorganisms did indeed enter, and they grew, and they made the broth cloudy. However, when he prepared a similar broth and sealed the flask, no microorganisms appeared. Now think for a second what the problem might be with this experiment. If we were asking this question nowadays, it would be suggestive that spontaneous generation is not a means by which microbes arise. However, it doesn't prove it. So think for a minute why that might be. And one of the reasons that might be is maybe air is important. What if air isn't introducing the microbes into the broth, but is required for the growth of the organisms? So, Louis Pasteur in 1861 addressed this question with a slightly modified environmental setup. Or experimental setup, excuse me. And what he did is he did a similar experiment to the previous one where sterile broth was in a container, except that instead of having the container directly open to the air, he had it set up with this S-tube. And what that allowed is that allowed air to get in, but the curve made it extremely difficult for microbes to enter into the broth. And as you might imagine, no growth was observed. When the flask neck was broken, that allowed bacteria to fall into the growth medium and growth was observed. There still is a little problem with this experiment. And some microbes do grow under these conditions. So let's take a look at the setup again, where you have this broth that has been boiled to sterilize it, and you have it open to air, but curved in such a way that excludes the microbes. The problem is that there are some microorganisms that still grew. In particular, the organism here that grew was Bacillus subtilis, and that is because it has a heat-resistant form, which is called an endospore. So a new experiment was set up to address this. Again, you have the same experimental setup, except what happened is that when a 10-minute boil took place, microorganisms grew. The second treatment involved 4 1-minute boils, each a day apart, and the observation was no growth. So take a moment to think about what is happening here. Why might these 4-minute boils each a day apart cause all of the microorganisms to die, whereas just one boil did not? So moving on, let's talk about microorganisms and disease. So previously we've just talked about the existence of microbes, we've talked about spontaneous generation versus biogenesis, but it took a surprisingly long time for people to figure out that microorganisms actually cause disease. In fact, some people thought that diseases were caused by supernatural forces, poisonous vapors, various imbalances. So people started to observe this connection between microbes and disease. And let me just take a moment to talk about why people took so long to figure out that microorganisms cause disease. Now let's take a step back and think about the experiment where microbes were observed on teeth scrapings. And presumably, von Leeuwenhoek, with the gentleman with the fabulous hair, did not have any particular oral disease when he took his teeth scrapings. He just had standard teeth. And what ends up happening is that people were finding microbes in all sorts of different environments. That is, in environments that were generally free of disease. And one thing that you'll come to appreciate during the course of the semester is that we live in a microbial world. There are microbes everywhere. And the vast majority of microbes don't cause disease in humans or animals. In fact, if I were to stand up in front of you, and if I were to take all of my human cells away, leaving just the microbial cells that live in and on me, you would be able to recognize me. And that's not because I'm a grimy old professor who doesn't bathe. I assure you that I do. But if I were to stand any of you up in the classroom and take away your human cells, just leaving the microbial cells, you would see the exact same thing. Now, people did eventually start to think about microorganisms and the fact that some microbes might actually cause disease. And this was called the germ theory of disease. And this was developed by Louis Pasteur. And he had the theory that transmission of germs caused disease. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to talk about scientific theories and learn about that in the context of the establishment of the fact that microbes cause some human diseases. Now, a few things on scientific theories. All scientific theories explain known observations, or explain many known observations. So an example of this is the transmission of rabies. So you can, the germ theory of disease explains the transmission of rabies. It provides a framework for understanding, so where diseases come from, and it can be tested further. So for example, do germs cause anthrax? One thing to note is a scientific theory is not a guess. And if I start hearing you talk about scientific theories as a guess, my daughter Nora will be very angry with you. So how do we test hypotheses? And the way that we can do that is we start out with a question. And based on your question, you develop a hypothesis. So in the particular example of the germ theory of disease, we start out with a question, what causes disease? And a hypothesis was developed, and that is that microorganisms or germs cause disease. So once you have the hypothesis, you need to develop an experiment or select information needed to test the hypothesis. So once you have selected the information needed to test the hypothesis, then you start doing observations and experimentations. And then you analyze your data. One possible result of your data analysis is that your hypothesis is supported. Something didn't come up that should have. Oh well. So if your hypothesis is supported, you expose your hypothesis to more tests and you refine your hypothesis. Another potential result is that your hypothesis is falsified. That is, that you show your hypothesis not to be correct. In that particular case, you reject your hypothesis and you quit science and go and work at the Taco Bell. Alternatively, you go back and reevaluate your question and hypothesis with the additional data that you gathered based on your observation and experimentation. You redevelop that and subject it to the same format. So let's talk about how this methodology was used in the context of the germ theory of disease. And we'll start out with selecting the information needed to test the hypothesis, because we've already got the hypothesis, that is, that germs cause disease. So we're moving to the information needed to test the hypothesis. What do we need to show in order for our hypothesis to be supported? In order to test the germ theory of disease, Robert Koch, a German scientist, developed a series of postulates, that is, if-then statements, that would allow him to address whether or not a bacterium or a microbe is the causative agent of an infectious disease. So, in other words, he set up a set of criteria that if each of those criteria were met, then that would demonstrate that a microorganism caused a disease. So we're going to go, and these are called Koch's postulates, and we're going to go over each of these four different postulates that were necessary for identifying the causative agent of disease. And the first criteria that must be met in order to demonstrate that a microbe causes a disease is that the microorganism or pathogen must be present in all cases of the disease. That is, if you identify someone with that disease that does not have the pathogen or the pathogen isn't present, then you cannot establish that that particular microbe causes that disease. Second is that the pathogen is isolated from the diseased host and grown in pure culture. And when we talk about pure culture, that means a culture in which no other microorganisms are present, a growth medium that only has one particular type of microbe. The third postulate is that if you introduce the pathogen or the microbe into a healthy individual, that individual becomes sick. And finally, the pathogen must be re-isolated from this newly sick host and shown to be the same as the original pathogen. So those are the four different postulates that he developed. And then he went on to develop a set of experiments to test or to go through those postulates. So the particular experiment that he designed was dealing with anthrax and rabbits. And we're going to go through each of the four different postulates and how you demonstrate that each of those postulates is true. The first one, that the microbe must be found in all cases of the disease but absent from healthy individuals. In this particular example, all of the healthy rabbits must not have that particular microbe, and the rabbits with the disease have to have the microbe. Now, the second postulate, that the pathogen can be isolated from the diseased host and grown in pure culture, is illustrated underneath the outline of the second postulate. So what that is showing is that the microorganism can be grown in pure culture in a laboratory setting. The third postulate is illustrated right here, and that is when you have this pure culture and you introduce microbes from the pure culture into a healthy, susceptible host, the same disease occurs. And Finally, the fourth postulate is illustrated here, and that is you must be able to obtain and re-isolate and grow in pure culture the same organism or same pathogen that was isolated in the first instance. Now, the application of Koch's postulates and pure culture techniques enabled a golden age in bacterial pathogen identification. That is, that people were able to start identifying that the particular causative agent, the microbial causative agent of diseases. Now, one thing that's important to note here is that you will be tested on all of the diseases, the causative agents, the discoverer, and the date. So you should commit all of that to memory. Just kidding. You don't have to do that. That would be ridiculous. Haha. The next topic that we're going to talk about is vaccine development. So this identification, or first of all, proving or finding evidence that supported the germ theory of disease and the experiments that allowed the hypothesis to be supported enabled people to address, well, now that we have established that microbes are the causative agents of disease, then how do we control infections by microorganisms? And one of the ways is through the development of vaccinations. So one example that we're going to go through is the smallpox vaccine. Now, one of the observations relating to smallpox is that milkmaids were protected from smallpox after contracting cowpox. So cowpox is a disease that is closely related to smallpox, but the severity of the disease is quite a bit lower. And so milkmaids who contracted smallpox or contracted cowpox were protected from smallpox. So Edward Jenner in 1788 developed a hypothesis that inoculating someone with liquid from cowpox sores gave high immunity to smallpox. That is, if you take a cowpox sore and you take the liquid from that sore and expose someone to that liquid, then that person would be subsequently protected from smallpox. Now, the experiment that he did to demonstrate this would never be allowed today, and if you think about it, it was incredibly risky. He inoculated an 8-year-old child with fluid from a cowpox lesion and exposed the boy to smallpox. And lo and behold, this boy didn't contract smallpox. Lucky for Jenner, lucky for the boy. And based on this information, Jenner developed the first vaccine using serum containing the cowpox virus. And interestingly, he tried this on 8 more children, including his own son, and none of these contracted smallpox. Now, as a corollary to germ theory, we can, now that we know that the germ theory of disease is supported, we can stop transmission. So if we stop the spread or transmission of germs, we can stop the disease spread. And that led to all sorts of epidemiological and public health measures to stop the spread of these germs. One thing that's interesting is that if you have a population and there's a subpopulation within that group that are resistant to the disease, that actually prevents the spread of germs. So there aren't as many vectors for transmission. And this is one reason why the trend of not vaccinating children can be a very large problem. So at low levels, so let's say that you have a large population of children and the vast majority of them are vaccinated. Well, there aren't a lot of vectors or hosts for the disease to grow in. That is, the disease can't infect individuals because they're all immune and therefore can't be spread. However, when you start getting larger and larger pools of unvaccinated children, then you get a situation which the disease can start to spread. And that's led to a whole lot of problems among communities of people that are anti-vaccination. I'd like to switch gears a little bit from talking about microbes and disease and turn to other types of microorganisms. So not all scientists were interested in medical microbiology. Some were interested in microbial processes and their role, first of all, in nature, so in the environment, and also their role in the good stuff that we enjoy. So Pasteur, once again, you're seeing this name come up, he showed that fermentation required an organism and that it wasn't a chemical process. So the fermentation of grapes to make wine and other fermentation processes actually required a microorganism. One kind of interesting tidbit is that beer and wine could sour as it aged. So if you made beer and wine, it could sour. And one of the solutions that was developed after Pasteur showed that fermentation required an organism is that you can heat to kill any bacterial interlopers. This also kills the yeast, but since fermentation is already completed and all that lovely alcohol has been made, that's not a big deal. What is this process called? Anyone want to take a guess? Pasteurization. I forget, you're not in front of me, I can't ask for a show of hands. This is called pasteurization. Now, the other part of the microbial world, besides disease and besides microbes' role in food, is microbial ecology. And this is becoming a much larger field lately, and that has been enabled by next generation high throughput DNA sequencing technologies, which we'll discuss a little bit later in the class. But a couple of things to note is that most microbes don't grow on typical laboratory medium. So that is that if you wanted to culture the vast majority of microorganisms on Earth, they wouldn't grow under laboratory conditions. And when I say the vast majority, less than 1% of microorganisms can be grown in standard laboratories. They live in a variety of conditions. So if there is a niche, chances are there's some type of microbe that's inhabiting that niche. They live in anaerobic conditions, so that is conditions that are devoid of oxygen, such as in the bottom of the swamp and in our gut. They can live at very high pressure, so they live at the bottom of the ocean. They can live at hot or cold temperatures. They can live at 0 degrees Celsius, below 0 degrees Celsius, actually, to over 113 degrees Celsius. And there are some that don't use any organic carbon at all. They don't need their daily sandwich to grow. They can use light for energy, and they can use carbon dioxide for their carbon. And microbes existed before plants or animals. And there was no oxygen in the Earth's atmosphere when microbial life developed. And it was cyanobacteria who produced oxygen that introduced oxygen into the atmosphere and enabled the evolution of plants and animals. A man by the name of Sergei Winogradsky was a pioneer in the field of microbial ecology. And he was a contemporary with Robert Koch. And what happened is that Koch's discoveries and the influence that had on human disease and then subsequent public health measures, that overshadowed the discoveries made by Winogradsky. However, one can argue that the discoveries in microbial ecology made by him were equally as important. And one of the things that I'm going to try and emphasize during this semester is that microbial ecology, that is, the microbes that live in the environment, though oftentimes ignored, especially in introductory classes, in favor of microbes that are important human diseases, this field is actually enormously important. And one of the reasons is that microbes are the fundamental drivers of biogeochemical cycles. That is, you hear about the carbon cycle, the nitrogen cycle, carbon cycles through soils. Microbes really drive these cycles, and we're going to touch more on that during the semester. And I certainly have a bias. A lot of my research is investigating the role that microbes play in the environment. For example, soon after the Gulf of Mexico oil spill, the Deepwater Horizon explosion, I was on a boat in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, right next to the wellhead, actually, and we were taking samples from the water and filtering the bacteria out of the water and investigating those bacteria to try and learn the mechanisms by which some of the bacteria were helping to degrade the oil. That is, they were eating the oil that was being spilled from the wellhead. So they become hugely important, and I want to make sure that when you leave this class, you understand that microbial ecology is just as important as medical microbiology. So that being said, back around Koch's time, people were starting to notice that there were samples, and within these samples, say in soil samples or sludge samples, the hydrogen gas was being oxidized, ammonia was being oxidized. All of these different chemical reactions were taking place, and the findings suggest that these weren't just reactions taking place that were abiotic, but that the microbes actually ate the hydrogen gas or ammonia instead of a sandwich, for example. The problem is that none of these microbes can be isolated in culture. I mentioned that earlier a very small percentage of microbes can actually be grown in laboratory culture. So that caused a substantial problem in that these processes appeared to be taking place, but you couldn't actually grow the microbes. So that's where Winogradsky comes in. And he developed what's called the enrichment culture technique and the use of selective media. And so enrichment culture is the use of selective growth media that supports certain classes of microbial metabolism while excluding others. One thing that enrichment cultures that can accomplish that pure cultures cannot is that many different microorganisms actually require other members of a community or a consortium to grow. So enrichment cultures, even though they're not pure culture, that is, you're not isolating the microbe to have it grow by its own, enrichment cultures allow you to grow groups of microorganisms that you may not be able to grow in isolation. So one of the things, or one of the ways that Winogradsky used to develop this enrichment culture was development of the Winogradsky column. I had a student once call it the Wayne Gretzky column, and even though it has absolutely nothing to do with hockey, that name has stuck in my brain ever since. However, if you call it the Wayne Gretzky column on an exam, you will not get credit, you will not even get pity points. Anyway, the Winogradsky column is a means by which an enrichment culture can take place. So what you're seeing here is a developed column, and actually if you take microbial ecology, I think that's, I forget what class number that is, but it's taught by Gilberto Flores, you may actually make some of these Winogradsky columns. I know that it's been done in the past under Paul Tomasek, and I'm not sure if Flores has plans to do that, but it's something you might do. But it's kind of interesting. What happens is that when you fill a Winogretsky column with mud or bacteria, shredded newsprint, which acts as an organic carbon source, calcium salts, and different inorganic carbon sources, and expose it to light for several weeks, you get this really cool gradient going on, and different microorganisms grow depending on where in the column you are. So at the very top of the column, what you have is you start out with this water, and it's aerobic. That means that there's oxygen in it. And in this top layer, you have cyanobacteria growing. And as you move down through the column, and the cyanobacteria, they're exposed to light, and the cyanobacteria can conduct photosynthesis using energy to split the water and produce oxygen. So below the aerobic water, below the cyanobacteria, what develops is you get purple sulfur bacteria that use, instead of splitting water, they actually split hydrogen sulfide, producing sulfur. So you get that as you move down through the column. And the byproduct of that type of photosynthesis is sulfate-reducing bacteria that produce hydrogen sulfide and precipitate iron. So you get this really neat column, and at each level in the column, you have different organisms performing different metabolisms based on what's available, and they actually use the byproducts of the metabolism as other organisms as electron sources and substrate for growth. For the purpose of the exam, you don't need to have memorized the Winogretsky column. That is, you don't need to know that you've got cyanobacteria, then purple non-sulfur bacteria, and as we move on down, that type of thing will go into detail later in the course, and by the end of the course, you will understand what it means when we say that a bacteria is sulfate reducing and produces hydrogen sulfide. So this acts as a little bit of a preview to what we're going to be studying regarding microbial metabolism. Moving on to the microbial family tree. And when we're talking about microbes, studying them in the context of a phylogenetic tree is extremely important. Now, if you haven't already gathered from the introduction to this class and this first lecture and through some of your other courses, microbes are incredibly diverse. They can do all sorts of crazy, kinky metabolisms that animals and plants can only dream about. It's really amazing the types of things that they can do. However, despite this enormous diversity in function, microbial species are incredibly difficult to classify. So if you think back to the slide where we're talking about the development of the microscope, and there was the little drawings of microbes, there were some that were kind of long and rod-shaped, and there were some that were circular, and that actually doesn't tell you a whole lot about what those microorganisms are. And, excuse me, what people have done then is, since shape often can't tell you a lot about microbes, is they use biochemical properties to classify. So when I say biochemical properties, there are a few ways. And one is the Gram stain. That is, you can stain the bacteria, and some cells will take up this stain, this purple stain, and others will not. And especially before the use of DNA to classify microorganisms, this was one of the very first steps in enabling people to classify microbes. They were often called gram-positive or gram-negative organisms. And in your 315 lab, you'll learn about gram staining, and you'll perform many gram stains and hopefully be very proficient by the end of class. Also, besides gram staining, people classify microorganisms based on the ability to metabolize different substrates. So again, in 315 lab, you'll actually go through a lot of the experimental procedures or the standard classification procedures people use to identify microbes. For example, you will do an experiment that determines whether or not organisms can use citrate as a sole carbon source. And if you're trying to identify a microbe, that becomes very handy. You can say, well, this microbe is gram positive and it can use citrate as a sole carbon source. So that starts to go a long way in telling you what the microbe is. And if you add in some other tests, you can get some pretty decent identification of what type of microbe you're dealing with. Nowadays, people are using DNA sequences to classify microorganisms. Before the use of DNA to analyze and to classify microbial life, people thought that archaea and bacteria were closely related to each other. Archaea tend to look very similar to bacteria. They're small. They just thought that they were slightly unusual bacteria that often can thrive in extreme environments. However, they have a very different biochemistry. And there are other differences. The archaeoribosomes are actually similar to eukaryotic ribosomes. And like I said previously, many live in harsh environments. So when people started sequencing the DNA of these organisms, what they did is they chose some particular gene sequences. So if you're trying to sequence DNA from all branches of the tree of life, you need genes that are present in all organisms. And so what people have typically used is ribosomal RNA gene sequences. So what these are is they're genes that encode the RNAs that make up the ribosomes. So these genes don't go through the standard process of DNA to RNA to protein. They get made into RNA, and then the RNA actually forms part of the ribosome. The key thing is ribosomal RNA genes, or rRNA genes, are found in all species. So if you sequence a ribosomal RNA gene, you can compare it with some caveats that we'll go into later. You can compare it among bacteria and archaea and eukaryotes. Like I said, there are some caveats, and the eukaryote ones are a little bit different, but you can make comparisons. So the point of this is that once they sequenced rRNA genes, they were able to build phylogenetic trees based on those sequences, and they found that actually archaea represent a completely separate domain of life, that they are not simply weird bacteria. And you can see that in this tree that I'm showing you. So here we are, animals. We're pretty closely related to fungi, and there are some slime molds we're not too distantly related from, or distantly related to. And you can see that archaea over here form a completely different domain. Now, we're going to look in a little bit more detail, or not detail, we're going to look at the tree a little bit differently in the next slide. And in this particular slide, you're still seeing the tree of life. You're seeing bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes. You're just seeing it drawn a little bit differently. Instead of the radial form, you're seeing the rooted version of the tree. Now, a couple of things that this particular tree shows is it shows that archaea and eukaryotes are actually more closely related to each other than either is to bacteria. That is, archaea are more similar, or I shouldn't say more similar, archaea are more closely related to us than they are to bacteria. And the way that you glean that information from the tree that I'm showing you here is by looking at the nodes. So the nodes of the tree are where branches come together. So on this tree, there are two nodes. And the node shows the last common ancestor between two branches. So in this particular case, here's Archaea. And as we move this way, we go back in time until we reach the node. And this particular node represents the last common ancestor between Archaea and eukaryotes. And it was a long time ago, because as you move backwards along the tree, you go back in time. However, you see that that node is more recent than the node between Archaea and bacteria. Now, excuse me, this is a little bit of an amorphous concept to understand. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw you something that is analogous so that can help you understand. Now, let's say that you have you and let's say you have your brother. And if you're drawing a tree that represents the relationship between you and your brother, this right here is the last common ancestor between you and your brother. And that is your parents. We're only going to use one parent as an example because it becomes a little more complicated. But you've got your parent or parents right here. That's the last common ancestor. However, if you want to look, say, at your cousin, you can draw something similar. And this node right here represents your grandparents. So the last common ancestor between you and your cousin is your grandparents. And so that's kind of how you can think of the tree of life in terms of relatedness and where the nodes are. So this is the end of the slides that I have for the first lecture. And I will be posting some more slides for lecture two, and then I will see you on Wednesday, since Monday is a holiday.